today I'm going to talk about a text written by Emile Durkheim, which is in the French title is Les Suicides, and the English translation of the book is Suicide. So this is in continuation with our whole idea of doing texts written by classical sociologists, anthropologists, psychologists, in order to understand the whole idea of the context of production, the context of distribution, and the context of reception. So keeping these in mind, let us try to understand a very important and a very classical text written by Emile Durkheim. And as we know, to take back that we have already done one of his earlier books, which was written by the same author, that is The Rules of Sociological Method. Now, keeping the whole idea that Durkheim is one of the founding fathers of sociologists, and his idea was basically to develop a science of the society. So he was writing the text with two objectives in mind: how to be able to understand reality from a scientific perspective, and how do we actually understand social reality as a social fact. So his book, The Suicide, is actually an elaboration of the rules of sociological method which he developed earlier. So, and this is a very important contribution, because we are trying to live in a time when there is so much of problem all around us, and we try to also see a large case of farmer suicide in a country. So this is important to understand a text which was written in the 1930s, to come back to how it helped us, both in the sense of understanding the society as such, as and also in terms of the development of the discipline of sociology. So let us go and look into why the book was written, what was the methodology that Durkheim followed in writing his text, how was it received, and what was the relevance of a text of a classical status in society, especially with reference to India. So we see that the first edition of the book Les Suicides appeared in June 1897 by Paris publishers Alcon. It was published very quickly, with a very short period of time, and it has been argued by a large number of scholars that it was published within 3 months of the submission of manuscript. Durkheim was still trying to do the proofreading and do the final minute corrections. And that in itself shows the relevance of a text which was required at the time. The second edition was written by his nephew Marcel Mauss and was published in 1930. It took a long period of time to get it translated into English, and it was only in 1951 that the text was translated by Spaulding and Jimson with the title Suicide, A Study in Sociology. So now let's try to understand what was the idea behind Durkheim when he started to think about writing about a problem which at that point of time was to be considered as individualistic, as something which was a kind of a mental disorder, and with that being individualistic, being a part of mental disorder, would belong to the realm of psychology. So prior to the publication of the book by Durkheim, suicide as a subject belonged to the discipline of psychology. With this we see that Durkheim actually wanted to bring out a text, because his intention was, remember to recall from my earlier lecture, that the two objective of Durkheim's writing was first to develop a science of the society, and so with the belief that if something like suicide could be which was individualistic, which was considered to be a personal problem, could be studied as a social fact by sociologists, then a science of the society was possible. The second was to apply an objective scientific method to understand a problem which was kind of emerging differently in different contexts and different spaces. So therefore we see that with his publication of the book The Suicide, it actually brought about a kind of a paradigm shift from something which was considered to be psychological, something which was considered to be individual, was so going to be supposed to be analytically studied by sociologists with the intention of studying it as a social fact. So we look into the whole idea of the change in the mindset in terms of considering suicide not as a kind of a psychological problem or not something which is emerging from the individual. And this is important to keep in the mind that Durkheim's intention was to focus on the collective. And that is what his works on the organic solidarity would show, that he was trying to understand how the moral order of the society could be collectively held together. And in he was applying to kind of a collective consciousness or trying to understand the collectivity through a problem which by till that point of a time was considered as individualistic. And therefore his study came out to be reject the understanding that suicide is not a psychological problem but something that arises from the degree of regulation and normlessness. Now these two terms, degree of regulation and normlessness, are central to the understanding of Durkheimian sociology, because he was very concerned about normlessness. He was very much concerned about the lack of social order in society, and therefore he was of opinion that suicide is not only emerging because of a psychological problem that an individual is facing, but more also it is something which is emanating from the lack of regulation in a society, or because of over-regulation, or it is either due to the normlessness or because of too much of emphasis of norms on individual's life. And therefore with the whole idea of regulation and normlessness, he does a mapping of the kinds of suicide and how the occurrence of society varies across religious beliefs, across gender, across economic, and therefore he comes out with a whole kind of a typology of suicide. Durkheim's this work is considered as his third major work, having written The Rules of Sociological Method and having written on the study of organic solidarity. But his work, Suicide, is considered to be the most influential work written by Durkheim because of the manner in which he conceptualizes the impact of social forces. And that is what is important to understand, that individuals are placed in a kind of a networking between the individual himself or herself and the social forces which are there. And this is what how he defines social fact. Remember, he said that social facts are things which are out there, external, which are constraining and which are a priority to our individuals. So all this theorization which he was able to do it in his Rules of Sociological Method, he is going to empirically provide an evidence of it through his study of suicide. The subject of suicide as an example of how a sociologist can study a subject that seems extremely personal with no social aspect to it, even being antisocial. So prior to the publication of the book by Durkheim, it was assumed that whole idea of those who are committing suicide would be antisocial. That is, they are not part of the social fabric of the society. So he was trying to change the idea that it is not something which is psychological, it is not something which is abnormal, it is not something which is pathological. He rather argued that suicide is such a personal act that it involves only personal psychology and it purely individual thought process. So it does not get limited through the individual's own mindset. And that is to keep in mind that individual is in a constant interaction with the society. So whatever he or she is doing in a society is outcome of the context in which the person is placed, and therefore any decision, and a decision like one to take one's life, is not only cannot be attributed to a psychological problems of an individual. Durkheim's aim was to not to explain or predict an individual tendency. So he's not doing a psychological understanding, or he's not even in his focus was not to actually predict who would commit suicide or which society would be more prone to suicide. What he was actually trying to do is that he's trying to understand that if there is variance in the occurrence of suicide across society, what is the reason behind it? And that he tried to do it by evolving a typology which is dependent on the type of society where the incidence is happening. So the first thing that we need to keep in mind is, and I have repeatedly said, that we need to consider suicide as a social fact. So this book came in immediately after the Rules of Sociological Method, and he tried to understand suicide as an example of how a sociologist could understand a subject that seems extremely personal with no social aspect and something which is outside the scope of individual. So I've already explained his objective of trying to develop a science of a society where one could understand a reality which was assumed to be something which is individual. And therefore, his intention was not to look into why an individual is committing suicide, but his understanding was more in terms of the collective, and that is the rate of suicide. And rate of the suicide in the sense that how many individuals, how many men, how many women from particular religion, from a particular type of society are being subject to or are being forced to take their life and commit suicide. So therefore, suicide rate is a social fact, something that is external to an individual. It is a product of the social structure of any given society. So that what is very integral to Durkheim's understanding of suicide. So now we go to the whole context, and keeping in mind the entire logic for which we are doing this series on key texts in social sciences and humanities, and try to understand what was the context in which the work was produced. So here I look into two kind of a context. One is a social context and the second part is the historical context. As I've already said, this book is a classical work, and it is one of the texts which is widely read, widely prescribed in the departments of sociology and other departments in order to understand the emergence of social science as a scientific objective study of social reality. It identified social factors involved in a very personal and intimate individual behavior. His work helps us to define what is the subject matter of sociology. So what is sociology supposed to do? Remember, this was a text also written at a time when the discipline of sociology was emerging. So the most important concern was to try to understand what is the subject matter of sociology. So in that context, it is trying to curl out the idea that sociology is the study of objective reality by using a scientific method of observation and comparison. The second contribution is that it helps to refine the relationship between the private troubles and the public issues. Now, we have already tried to do it in the first very lecture in the key text on talking about social imagination and sociological imagination, a text written by C. Wright Mills, and we try to see that how our private troubles are actually linked to the public issue. So the interconnections is very important, and we see it's something which is coming in from the kind of a Durkheimian understanding of social reality. Third, it is based on empirical and statistical data. So he actually collected a lot of statistical data, and when I do a kind of a critical review of his text, we'll see there are a lot of criticism which says that his text was based on large amount of primary data which he himself did not collect. So that's one of the limitations. But remember, it's a time when sociology was just emerging. So trying to first describe what is the subject matter, and then trying to articulate that what is the methodology or what is the technique that the sociologist should adopt in order to understand social reality. And this was part of the positivist school, where there was a focus on empirical reality through statistical data. It gives rise to an objective and quantitative research method in sociology. So that was the whole idea that the sociology over the years have changed, and there's a lot of kind of divergence from what was being articulated, but then it still continues to form the base or the framework for sociology as a discipline. Then we look into the historical context. His research on suicide should be placed also in a historical context, because it is very important to understand the history in order to try to understand why would a person belonging or trying to be considered as a part of the discipline of sociology write a text of something which is not within the scope of it. So that historical changes would help us to understand that. And that is that huge changes were taking place during this period, and one of the changes which was impacting society to a large scale, and where there was a kind of a debate between the individual and the collective, was the process of industrialization. So large scale industrialization was taking place in most of the Western country. There was a shift from a kind of a peasant society to an industrial society. There was changes happening in family, marriage, role. And these changes which was taking place because of industrialization could be attributed as one of the factors which was pushing people towards a kind of decision to end their life. So people were leaving the countryside because of various forces like migration, pull factors. People were leaving their homes, coming to the cities to take up new jobs. They were not being able to fulfill their aspirations. And the life in the factories was completely different from the life that they were living in. So these are the social fabric which he is trying to say was actually influencing individuals' desire towards committing suicide. So individuals were leaving behind what was familiar, resettling in cities with other people from other areas, with other culture. So there was a lot of change in kind of a social relations, in kind of the lot of shifting was taking place, and people had to bring about a change in their lifestyle, in the culture, in the language, in order to adjust to a new environment. And many a time, this whole failure to actually adjust to a new space might could be the triggering factor. So what are the influences? Next, what we need to try to understand that what actually influenced Durkheim to write a text like suicide. And we see that at that point of time, there were a large number of newspaper reports highlighting the increased number of suicide among economically well-off and more among widowers than widows. So these newspaper reporting, the journalists were reporting. So that implies that the incidence of suicide was actually a problem that needed an sociological investigation. So this number of newspaper reporting was one of the influence that could have asked Durkheim to look into it from a sociological perspective. Durkheim collected data to show this the whole occurrence of suicide through scientific and analytical study. So you he was trying to not focus on the kind of just numbers, that these are the number which is happening, but he was trying to understand why the number, why the rate in such a society, and if it's a high in one society, why is the rate so high? The third factor that influenced him was that his very close friend at Ecole, the normal place where he was pursuing his higher study, Victor Home committed suicide due to feeling of isolation. So we see that this whole idea of feeling isolated was not only there among the certain class of the people or people who were migrating, but it was also part of the academia, where people going in for higher degrees, higher educations, were feeling the whole sense of alienation, the feeling the whole sense of isolation, and people were committing suicide. So the death of his very close friend could actually influence him to ask the question why the rate of suicide is on an increase, and he was prompted to do a research in this field. Now let us come to the method. as we have already looked into when we are I was talking about why he's selected, was the whole idea that he belonged to the positivist school of social sciences, and his was focus was to study on any social reality from a scientific and a objective manner. And that, in that sense, we've seen that he's used a lot number of statistical data, quantitative data. So his method was to study suicide from a qualitative and a quantitative method. Nowadays, many people use the term mixed method for it, but it was into a kind of a detailed scientific analysis of the suicide rate in different parts of the the world. He studied official suicide statistics from 1840 to 1870, taken from a range of European societies looking at suicide rate. And he's looking at the suicide rate on the basis of these three or four criteria over a time in the same society. So a particular period in the same society has a low rate, and a certain period could have a higher rate. So he's trying to understand what is the factor behind the difference in the rate of the suicide rates. In different society, for instance, so he was trying to understand the Catholic society, the Protestant society. Why would suicide rate be, say, higher among the Protestants and low among the Catholics is a subject that he needed to investigate. Between different subgroups in the same society, and therefore, and as we know, and we have already gone through this several times, that his method was two. One was an observative scientific method, and second was comparison. And that is the reason he's studying a wide range of society to compare what is existing, or what are those modes of regulation and norms in the society which is actually causing the suicide rate to be low or to be higher. His methods showed how to test hypotheses, reject incorrect explanation for suicide, sort through a great variety of possible explanation, and attempt to control for extraneous factors. He noted three things. Within single society, the suicide rate remains constant over a time. And that is why, because social fabric doesn't change very quickly. It takes a kind of some period of time for the social fabric to change, social relations to change. So the suicide rate will more or less be stable in one particular society over a period of time. Second, there are significant differences in the suicide rate between societies. And that again will come in the later part to see the why is there a difference in suicide rate, and that could be because of the norms of normlessness or the degree of regulations. Third, within the same society, there are significant difference between different social groups, and that could be how each group is responding to the social reality. And that could be that if one group is attached to the society, the rate of suicide could be less, and if it is not detached, could be the rate is higher. So that is what he was trying to investigate. The basic question in Durkheim's mind was, suicide has a social dimension. And this is where I began, that he's trying to say that something which is individual, something which is psychological, need not just stand there. We need to explore beyond that. And that's what sociology does, goes beyond the commonsensical. And in that sense, he came to an understanding that suicide is social fact. And the reason why people commit suicide is not only because of the individual psychology, mental imbalance or mental disturbances, but to a large extent dependent on the religion, class factor, gender factor. And he has come through in his work saying sowing rate, which is higher among people following a certain religion, certain difference in the suicide rate across men and women. So that is what he's trying to do, is go deep into the social meaning of why something is like suicide was taking place in certain society. The answer that he gave to his question was that group in which there is a good balance between individual initiative and communal solidarity have low rate of suicide. So this takes us back to his main idea that he was, and I have already said in the beginning that Durkheim was more interested in trying to understand the moral order of the society, the factors that would keep it integrated. So he's saying that in societies where individuals are able to relate to the society, the rate of suicide would be less. In other words, if society is taking care of the individual's needs and desire, rate of suicide would be low. Durkheim arrived at his hypothesis, the basic cause of suicide was social in nature. So he looked at two social factors which might shape the likelihood of an individual to commit suicide, and that is the degree of regulation and number two, normlessness. So he's looking into a large number of intersectionalities which would help us to understand suicide as a social fact or suicide as a social problem. So he's looking into religion, he's looking into marital status. Are married women committing more suicide or unmarried men committing more suicide? Geography, certain part of the world which is kind of cut off from the rest of the world, the rate of suicide is high. And gender, and the most important is military affiliation. And military affiliation help us to understand the number of deaths that has happened in military. Is a kind of a name of a nation, in name of the suicide, that people actually give up their life. So he noted that those at a higher risk of killing themselves, or in other words, the suicide rate is high among men, residents of larger cities, Protestant is a part of Christianity, which has a certain kind of belief in the whole idea of work as capital, in the sense that the more you work, the more blessed you are, and the whole idea that God has selected you on the earth in order to work, make more and more work, and invest it into more profit. So that there is a tendency where suicide rate could be higher in terms of age factor. Older people have a higher rate of suicide than the younger ones, or higher social standing and education level. And so these are some of his statistics that he came out with. Now looking into the whole idea of the context, the influences, the method, now let us look into the content of the book. What is the book actually trying to tell us? And we see that the book is divided into three parts. The first section of the book is trying to tell us about the facts of suicide which lied on the surface. That is, what were the ways in which suicide was being studied. And as I have already said, that it was being considered as an individual problem belonging to the realm of psychology. So sociologists had nothing to do with. So he's trying to do away with these assumptions and come to an understanding that suicide is completely a social problem to be investigated by sociologists. The second section, he is trying to build up on a typology. And we'll see that very soon that he's given us four types of suicide, and he's trying to draw kind of a mapping in terms of the degree of regulation and normlessness. He has categorized types of society. In his third section of the book, it's related to suicide to the conditions of society as a whole. So after drawing a kind of a typology, he's trying to say that which kind of suicide is higher in which type of a society, and why is it so? What are the conditions existing in the society which is responsible for the rate to be high or low? And very important when we do text and we try to understand classical text like the one which we are trying to do, we see that the major contribution is in terms of theory building. That how did he contribute in terms of build a theory which would help us in order to understand society. Suicide represents the first clear outline of Durkheim's vision of functionalism. And that is what was his kind of methodology, that he was trying to understand the functions which part of the society was going to contribute for the maintenance of the whole. The theory highlighted the manner in which structural foundations form the basis of society, and society is made up of interdependence forces that interact and impact upon one another. So the whole idea of organic analogy, and I've also said earlier that his organic analogy, he was influenced by Spencer's theory of organic, and he's saying the society is like an organism, which each part are connected to the other and each contribute, are interdependent upon each other, each contribute for the functioning of the whole. Suicide shows us how fluctuations in structure factors like family or economy play a direct or univocal role in fostering the desired climate for tendency towards suicide. So taking us back to the whole idea that the parts of society are related to each other, so we don't treat the family and the economy and the polity as separate institutions, but as a web or a network which each influences the other. So there's a change in the family structure, there could be individual is impacted by it, so there could be a higher or a lower chance of moving towards anomy and normlessness, and higher chance of the person committing suicide. Change in the economy, we see that especially with reference to India, farmers' suicide in India is a change in the economic structure where farmers have not been able to attain the kind of economic sufficiency that they wanted, and this has prompted a large number of farmers in our country to commit suicide. So we cannot say that when a large number of farmers in our country are committing suicide, it is something of an individual problem of the farmers. It is a problem which is emerging from the economic base of the country, and this we need to go back to the whole way in which post 1991 there was a kind of liberalization the whole way in which private sectors came in and industries and capitalism has accelerated, but the agrarian structures of our country is still stagnant, and that is the social factor for the commitment of suicide among farmers. Most important contribution in theory building is that Durkheim's contributed to sociology of knowledge, because he's trying to make an attempt to relate systems of thought to states of the collective consciousness. And that's very important, to try to understand how individual, the way one thinks, the way one acts, the way one behaves in a society is not only an idea coming from an individual or something coming from a vacuum, but it is something which is coming from the context in which an individual is, and also in terms of how that individual is connected to the society. And that, in a way, help us to understand a lot about the structures of the society. Among the very first example of consistent and organized use of statistical method in social investigation, he is considered to have invented statistical technique to examine social reality. Suicide outlined a clear and certain terms how different social phenomena are relying upon others and how this affects social outcome as a whole. He provides an institutional framework such as the economy, family and political system, and all act as integral part of the social structures in which society is based. When a social structure fails in the aims, there is a consequent impact upon the wider social functions and individual experiences. For Durkheim, it was more than a mental illness, and a social force external to individual increased the likelihood that members of certain groups or categories were more likely to take their own lives than the other. Thus, he defined the term suicide as applied to all cases of death resulting directly or indirectly from a positive or negative act of the victim himself or herself, which he knows will produce this result. So that is the definition of suicide in his book, and this very well highlights the whole idea of how much of social forces has an influence on individual thinking in the development of the ideas of taking a very important decision of ending a life and knowing the consequences of that act. So it cannot be just studied as an individual psychological fact. Comparative statistics for countries and categories of people within each country showed that suicide rates were relatively constant. Therefore, it must be a social fact that a collective tendency towards suicide exists. And that was one of the main criteria of trying to understand what is social fact. And in his book, The Rules of Sociological Method, Durkheim says that any reality, anything is a social fact when it has three characteristics. It is external, it is coercive, and it is a priori. So if the rate is constant over a period of time, implies that it is irrespective of individual's behavior. And therefore, it has to be understood in the collective rather than the individual. The collective tendencies could be related to a set of causes to produce a classification of types of suicide. And as I said already, that the two key factors which helps to understand suicide as a social fact are social integration and regulation. Integration is the extent of social relations bringing a person or a group to others such that they are exposed to the moral demands of the group. So integration is from a very Durkheimian perspective is the whole idea where an individual is able to sacrifice the individual needs and desire in the name of the society. So the society comes first, and that is how an individual finds himself or herself as a part of the larger whole. Regulation is defined as the normative or moral demands placed on individuals that come with membership in a group. So each membership of any group or any society comes with a whole list of certain norms, certain guidelines that has to be accepted in order to be a part of the society. And the society as a whole ensures that these norms and moral orders are maintained. So in other words, the society regulates the, so wherever the regulation is high or low, the suicide rate will vary accordingly. So talking about that, he does a typology or gives us four types of suicide. So we see that the four types of suicide are actually placed on the kind of continuum, and keeping in mind the two thing is integration and regulation. So we see the altruistic society suicide is on the higher side. So if there is too much of integration, altruistic would be that you give up your life for the welfare of the society. So that means that you're truly deeply integrated in the, and the example would be the kind of a death in military war or conflict, army conflict. The other side of the continuum is the kind of a less integration into the society, and that is egoistic suicide. That is, one is more concerned about an individual rather than the larger part of the society. So if an individual is not able to find himself or herself a part of the society, he is too much into thinking about me and myself and I, there is a tendency to commit suicide, and that is egoistic suicide. Then, so second criteria was kind of a regulation. So on one extreme, we see the anomic suicide. Anomy is a condition of normlessness. So anomy is kind of normlessness in itself, is that there is no regulation. So a society where there is no norms, there is no regulation, there is a situation that people will not find themselves in place, and there would be a tendency to commit anomic suicide. The other side of the continuum is fatalistic suicide, where regulation is on the extreme, too much of regulation. So people are not able to take up too much of regulation, too much of restrictions, too much of curbs on individual freedom. So in that tendency, if individuals commit suicide, Durkheim labeled it as fatalistic suicide. Now, when we look into the typology, we see that suicide varies inversely with the degree of integration of religious society. So we see that it is the least in among Jews, then Catholics and the Protestants. So if regulation is higher, obviously the degree of suicide rate would be high. Suicide varies inversely with the degree of integration of domestic society. So the whole idea would be, in order to That's what Durkheim is saying, that among married male, it is less compared to unmarried male. And there's a lot of criticism from gender perspective, but I'll look into it later. Suicide varies inversely with the degree of integration of political society. So in rural society, as a more integrated or very close society, suicide would be less. Higher in urban society because integration is weak. Though we say less among wartime people, peacetime it increases. And so that is the space and time analysis that he comes out with certain kind of statistical understanding of the problem. Now let me briefly talk about the four types of suicide that he is talking about. I'm not going into detail of it, but just trying to understand what Durkheim meant by these four types. Anomic suicide is a term for a lack of social integration, and as I've already said, which is a situation where there's no norms, there's no regulations. People find themselves kind of unregulated, and therefore they are not able to cope up with the changes in society, and they are at a higher risk of society. We'll use the term which Karl Marx used, similar to anomic, is alienation, that we are not being able to actually find ourselves part of the society, so we are alienated. Then we say that gender, in most society, men have more freedom and are more independent than women. While this might sound a little good thing, it can actually lead men to feel that they have few significant relationships with other group, and that it would be an admission of weakness to seek advice or confront from others. And this could be a situation of kind of factor which could actually lead them to suicide. So this was a justification by Durkheim, while married men would be less prone to suicide, and unmarried men who have larger level of freedom would be committing a higher level of suicide. Religion, I have already discussed. The Protestant religion were likely to commit suicide more than Catholics or Jew because its religious practices are more demanding. It kind of regulates individual life. And among the Protestant, the belief is that there is no space for luxury, there is no space for lavish expenditure. And the whole idea is that the more you earn, the more you invest, the more profit you earn, the more selected selected few you are. So the higher the economy or the higher the kind of a profit you are being made is a signal that you are a blessed one, that God has actually blessed you. So that kind of focus where life gets restricted to certain economic activities is a reason why there's a tendency towards committing more suicide. Then the third kind of anomic suicide could be in terms of your marital status. Durkheim used the idea of social integration to explain the higher suicide rate among unmarried people. He concluded that people who were not married had fewer connections to other people and were less likely to feel part of the larger community. So the integration level is low, and that therefore there could be a kind of an lack of attachment to the society and a tendency towards committing suicide. Then we come to the second type, where the fatalistic suicide, which is a society which there is a emphasis on norms. So this is just opposite of anomic suicide. It is a result of excessive regulation. It occurs in a society where norms are imposed by an authority extended to the group. So society which are very conservative society, a fundamentalist society which lays down a lot number of guidelines, large number of restrictions on individuals' mobility, individuals' modes of action, individuals' behavior, the tendency would be to actually commit or be part of the fatalistic society. The person finds oneself in a situation from which there is no escape. So you find yourself actually kind of imprisoned by norms and regulations, and you're not being able to come out of that prison. So the ultimate decision would be to take up, end your life. The example of fatalistic suicide would be very young husbands, childless, married women, slaves, etc. So they are people whose futures are blocked and whose passions are suppressed in an oppressive discipline. But Durkheim thinks that this type of suicide is unimportant in modern society. He also to keep in mind that his understanding was of the modern society. So he's not much concerned about the fatalistic suicide. His larger discussion in his book is on anomic suicide because of this emphasis on the shift of society from simple society to a complex society, which is also a part of his work, where he's trying to see how organic solidarity is emerging from mechanical solidarity. So his book, his writings are more or less a kind of a connected, he's not changing his methodology or diverging from what he's saying in one book, and he's continuing with his stand. In his book, it was mentioned only in the footnote. So that is why we are trying to say that he was not much concerned about fatalistic suicide. And he's also trying to argue in his text that this is a kind of suicide which was found more in simple traditional society. So he's mentioned it only in the footnote, and he has not mentioned in his typology. So many a time when we read Durkheim, people say that there are three types of suicide, that is anomic, altruistic and egoistic. So people don't talk about the fatalistic suicide as such. We come to the third type of suicide, which is altruistic suicide. This is produced by predominance of societies on individuals to the degree of destroying the consciousness of the own personality. So you live not for yourself, not for your individual life, but you live for the society. So whatever action you do, whatever behavior you do, is part of a reflection of what you're doing for the society. So if the society demands that you end up your life, you will as well give it for the welfare of the society. So the person is seen as of little or no consequence. So his individual agency is not important, and therefore the consequences of him giving up his life is considered as something which is celebrated, as something which is considered to be romanticized. So that is a situation where the integration is on the higher side. Integration of the individual with the group becomes a strong sense, and he is able to sacrifice his individual life. And that is how when we read stories of war and stories of military death, when we look into large number of cases where very young men went up, took a job in military, who was newly married, had a child, but then because he was on the war front fighting for his country, he was ready to give up, sacrifice his love, his life, and selected to actually neglect or kind of not think about the family which he's leaving behind. So that was why altruistic suicide would be higher in society which the level of integration of individual into the society is at a very high degree. It is a voluntary death. In a very specific circumstances, society deems significant of praise or prestige. And we know that at least the victims of war are always applauded, are always given award after the death of the individual. And that is the logic that you need to give up your life for protecting the larger society. So, and you need to be awarded for taking your own life. It only occurs in society where group membership is elevated above the individual self-worth. It is more common in lower societies, that is non-Western societies, because in Western society the whole idea of individualism has come in, and there are certain kind of research, certain kind of reading of the army or the military intake also says that there are a large number of or a larger percentage coming in from the lower class, from the villages, from the rural area, because maybe the sense of belonging to a group is more among the rural simple society than would be found in a society in the cities and urban spaces which is less integrated. He does, however, identify the military as the only context in which altruistic society is likely to occur in Western society. So the whole idea was that even if we look into kind of a kinship structures in simple society, was such that the identity, the personality of an individual was not his own personality, it belonged. So if one individual committed a crime or any kind, then this, the demand was to actually sacrifice his life for the welfare of the society. So that was a kind of altruistic society in simple society. And his example from the modern society is suicide, which is happening in the due to war and in the military. The fourth type of suicide is egoistic suicide. Egoistic suicide is a situation where the individual's own life is the center of the focus. More important in the society is about one's own concern. Ego, if you look into Freud, the ego was the self. So we are very more focused about one's own life, one's own desire, one's own success, failure in life, and that means that one is detached from the larger whole, from the collectivity, and therefore you're not being able to actually express your concern or your desire, your anger with the rest of the society, and therefore there could be a tendency towards taking one's life. Egoistic society suicide is committed by people who are not strongly supported by membership in a cohesive social group. Detachment from society results in detachment from life because society gives meaning to life. Example of this would be people deep in depression with no future goal, change in any kind of a say from you are just thrown out of job from a very high post, so you'll not be able to take that and could be a cause of suicide. So there are several kinds of examples which he is trying to say, but we keep in mind that his idea was degree of attachment to the larger whole. So I have actually done a kind of a typology of suicide, which could be type of society which could be done, but I have already explained that suicide varied according to the degree of integration and the degree of normlessness. So we try to understand the third section of the book, which is suicide and conditions of society. Suicide phenomena is socially constructed, which is independent of individual. The collective tendency which determines society have their own social and moral minds, so they were external to the individual. Social regulations and integrations were vital in the society, that if society over-regulated or under-regulated, there is a chance of the rate being shifted. We also see that same kind of a work were being produced at the same period. And we need to read these also, and we know Weber working on Protestant ethic and the rise of capitalism, and his argues that the Protestants, the capitalism is more profound because of the kind of religious belief, and this is the same kind of argument that Durkheim is saying. So we have then Protestantism was a key factor for understanding kind of economy and the suicide. So Durkheim was not the only one who was talking of it, and there were other sociological thinkers who were talking at the same time. I've already said that concept of alienation was used by Karl Marx, which is very similar to what Durkheim is talking about, anomic suicide, and this could be related to the large scale of disintegration that was happening due to the rise of industrialization and the emergence of new cities. So we see that his book, The Suicide, is being written in a social and historical context in which the understanding of suicide as a social fact was relevant in order to understand the wider changes taking place in the society, economy, and political structure. But very quickly, I'll go through the criticism of Durkheim, because there are a large number of criticism which has been done. And one of the important criticism is his use of statistical method. There are a lot of debates on how he did it, what was the methodology of collection of data. He himself did not collect data. His nephew, Marcel Mauss, helped him in collecting. Then the second criticism is there's a vagueness in terms of concepts that he's using, integration, anomie, individualism, large number of concepts which he's using synonymously, but they need a large number of clarity. And then also the assumption about religion And also categorization that all protestants would be prone to kind of committing suicide is something which could be problematic. Interactionist argued that official suicide statistics, his work was based on collecting data from the official record, could actually will not be sufficient authentic data to understand the nature of suicide, because it might have left out a large number of suicide that could have gone unreported. So interactionists go to actually go and actually collect data from the field in order to understand the whole idea. Then Douglas believes that Durkheim's work flawed and argues that whether sudden death is classified as a suicide, and how would we look into military death as kind of a suicide, and how do we compare somebody who is lost a job doing suicide, somebody going on war as suicide. So he, Douglas has done an extensive criticism of Durkheim's work. And what is very important is that there are a lot of criticism, no doubt. Any kind of a productive work will have criticism. And criticism is not always to be looked into the negative side. It is something which will actually contribute to improving the work, which is. But besides all this kind of criticism, what is very important to understand the relevance of suicide even today in terms of understanding society. And we see today's society, the rate of suicide has gone high, depression has gone high, and individualism has come. So, and I have already given example of farmer suicide. There are different kinds of suicide which is taking place. So we need to read Durkheim's book in the light of the current things which are taking place. With this, I come to an end to today's lecture.